You mentioned earlier that part of how you picked up, you struggled with that, is that you were hiring a lot of people that you were very close to. And I'm also curious to hear your thoughts around hiring friends, family, or people we are close to.
It only becomes a difficult thing when they start slacking. You need to reprimand them as an employer and
Yeah.
not as a friend. Bad things will always be taken as a friend. The
Yeah.
good things will always be taken as an employer.
Is there specific things that you are doing or that you do to stay ahead of the game for your business?
I always say that my best project is my next project.
Yeah.
Having a favorite project means that you have a favorite child and you think that you can't do anything better than that.
What are you learning the most about yourself in your entrepreneurial journey?
I'm too kind.
Where do you think that comes from? Why do you think you're too kind?
As young people, many of us are coddled from the real world
Yeah.
and we're protected from the realities of what the world is until you become an adult and then you have to face, rejection and how bad the world can be too late in your life. Like, business is the most personal thing ever.
Absolutely.
Like, people always say it's not personal, it's just business, but business is very personal for everyone. Nobody's doing this right now. Let's drive to Sun City. Get access, no matter how it works, just get on the carpet, take pictures, edit them on our phones quickly, and then post them.
Hello, Resonate community, and welcome to the best and the biggest sales and entrepreneurship podcast in the whole wide world. It is never a podcast episode until I say I am excited because today, sitting with me is the sought after. If you don't have a picture by this gentleman, I need you to know that you have a lot of work to do because kalokutina aba successful that are building, that are, we've got a picture from this photographer. Okay. Today I'm joined by Austin Malema, or should I say the
Oh my God.
Austin
There's the thing, right? I need to know who started it and how it spread like wildfire like that because it's always, are you the?
Yeah.
And I'm like,
Let me tell you,
well.
it's you became the when you started photographing like our favorite celebrities. And then we were just like, ah, kaloku, we also want. You know what I mean? And then you became the, but it's undeniable that your work is amazing.
Oh, thank you very
That's what makes you the.
much.
So
Thank you
welcome
for
to the
having
Resonate
me. Thank you
podcast.
for having me.
I'm excited to chat to you. I've been wanting to chat to you for a long time.
Ooh, let's get into it.
Yeah. Okay, cool. So before we start,
Yes, ma'am.
I normally do a fire round of questions just to get to know you a little bit. And I prepared some questions for you that I think are
Ooh-wee.
going to be very interesting. I was like, this would be a very interesting question to ask Austin. Because as a sought-after photographer,
Yes,
right,
ma'am.
I want to know if you could photograph any historical event, what would it be?
Ooh, never really thought of that.
Yeah.
Any historical event. Ooh, that's a tough one. There's too many great things that have happened in life
Yeah.
to think about, but I would probably want to photograph. I don't want the simple things that everybody will want to go to, like Nelson
Okay.
Mandela coming out of prison. Oh, that was great. But I want to experience something that's great or something out of this world.
Yeah.
Probably the first heart transplant.
Wow.
Yeah, there's pictures of it. So it also, you're a contributor to history.
Oh, shucks. I thought it would be something like a Muhammad Ali fight, like kind of
You know
thing.
that when you say that Rumble in the Jungle picture,
Yes.
that, oh my God, I
Yeah.
always think about that picture and I'm like,
Yeah.
whoever came up with the idea to shoot that image,
Yeah.
like, I don't know what they were on that day,
Yeah.
but they were on one. Like,
Onto
oh
something.
my God. Like, that picture is
Oh.
always like one picture. I'm like, maybe if I'd photographed that picture,
Yeah.
I would go down in the history books, but I think I'm doing well enough now.
I love that. Do you ever look at like somebody in your industry and then you see what something that they've done, and you're just like, I should have done
Yes, I do quite a
that.
lot.
Tell me one.
I do a lot. I
It's like
do a lot.
it's like it's a me thing. Why
Oh
did they
my
do it? I
God.
should have done that.
I think there's always certain projects that happen, right? And
Yeah.
they may have come past you and then you're like, yeah, maybe not this one. And then you see the actual results and then you're like, damn, I should have said yes.
Yeah.
So it also happens a lot within my own team. So okay. I've got a group of guys that will go shoot something and then I'll pass on the job and I'll be like, nah, you can go do it.
Okay.
And then they come back and I'm like, damn, I'm really jealous now. I should have done that. I should have done that. And then they always laugh at me, but they're like, yeah, but it was your job and then you passed on it. And I'm like, yeah, but I didn't think it would look so great in the air.
Yeah, it's like, it
happens too many times. I think that I just need to remember which specific one. And I was having a conversation with someone about it.
Yeah.
I think about a week or two ago, there was a specific job that I saw. Oh, it was with Loot Love.
Okay.
I had a conversation with Loot Love this past weekend. Mm-hmm. And there is the cover that she did with her kids.
Ooh, I saw that.
That cover?
Oh my God.
That thing, I had to do like a quadruple take on the image.
Oh,
and I'm like, I wish I did that. Yeah. But then I also said, I don't know if I would have killed it like that.
Oh, wow.
I know it would have been great, but I don't know. Like, you know, you sit there and you admire other people's work.
That's
and
true,
you're like, oh my God. And that was by George Q. And he did such an amazing job on that thing. And I was like, damn, I photographed Loot for so long and someone found such a different look for her. And it was so beautiful. So that's one of those things.
It's like, is it like a bit of jealousy, but with like admiration?
Yes. It's, I wish I had done that because of how good it looks.
Yes.
Because I think, I don't know if people will understand it as jealousy or admiration, but it's a bit of both where you're like, this is beautiful. I wish I had done that.
Yeah.
I wish I took that shot.
Yeah.
As it is.
Yeah.
Because of how good it is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Shucks. Okay, that's interesting. What do you look forward to every single morning?
Ooh. The opportunity to try again.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I always believe that no matter what happens, when you wake up in the morning, no matter what happened the day before, you've got an opportunity to do it again and do it better. Mm, that's the best thing.
It's like the newness of each day.
Yeah, it's always an opportunity to get up from zero and then end at 50% or 100% on that day.
Yeah, that is so good. So what piqued your interest in photography? How did you land up there? And I ask this because as a person of color, I don't know about you, but we grew up being told to be radiologists, doctors and lawyers and all these things. And photography wasn't a thing that like was really spoken much about. And it wasn't as valued as it is now.
Yeah.
So
I don't think I knew I was going to be a photographer at any point, and it was nothing that I considered. I always wanted to be famous, right? And I always wanted to be rich.
Okay.
So I think the one way I thought I'd do it is working on TV as something. Okay. So tell your funny story. I auditioned to the NSA twice in grade 9 and grade 10 and failed both years because I thought I was going to be an actor at first.
Wow.
When I realized that I couldn't do that, I was like, it's fine. I'll be a director.
Okay.
So I knew I'll always be in the industry in one way or another. Even after high school, I didn't apply to any varsity. I only applied to film school. And I went to film school and I was like, this is my path.
Yeah.
Like not trying to find another option. This is what I'm doing.
Yeah.
And when I was in film school, I was like, cool, I want to be a director. That I changed my mind from being a director because they were like, who wants to be rich? Everybody put their hands up and they said, if you want to be rich, then be a producer. It's like, okay, then I definitely want to be a producer.
So you were just following where the money was.
Where the money was, that's where I was going to go.
Okay.
But then, you know, while I was in film school, I realized that I need to do something to make money on the side for myself, right?
Okay.
I did not come from a very well-off family. I had a mother who could pay for my varsity fees. Mm-hmm. And I had to find a way to, you know, entertain myself, to also have fun. And the best way to do it was to take photos.
Mm-hmm.
And also with taking photos, it would give me access to events that I never had access to.
Ooh.
So it became a thing of opportunity to get into these events and also make money out of it.
Mm.
And from that, I kind of, you know, created a name for myself. I would go to a party and I would shoot the after movie and then it would go out the next day or the following week. And then it would be like, okay, cool. This is cool. And then it kind of built my repertoire up, and then people started finding who I was mm-hmm. from shooting videos. And I was like, oh, this is great. But then I really want to take photos. And then I just started taking photos. And then it became a career out of, you know, just the interest in meeting new people
yeah.
and meeting famous people in, you know, getting into the club, getting into the party. I didn't want to pay to get into the club. So I'm like, how am I going to get paid yeah. to be in the club and still hang out with the cool people?
Yeah.
And I picked up a camera, and it really, like, you know, changed my life from, you know, from that day on.
Yo, so you started taking photos in the club. Was that like where it actually started?
At events, not in the club. Okay. Then I moved on to the club. So started doing events, daytime events mm-hmm. and nighttime events. Mm-hmm. Just, you know, capturing that those images. It was the time of thunder.com, you know,
yeah.
and those guys were at every event.
Mm-hmm.
And when I got into varsity, I was like, yo, I'm not cool enough to be invited to all these things. So I want to get in.
Yeah.
So what am I going to do? If I'm going to get in, I need to find a way to make myself accessible, you know, for people to be like, we always want this person here. And then I started taking photos, and I remember I'd get paid like 500 rand for a night of photography, and that was like ridiculous at that time. Or it was a lot of money when you look back at it, and then you're like, okay, cool, making 500, I can go party with my friends for the next 2 days. 500 rand.
Wow.
Oh, I can buy myself a nice pair of sneakers that I wanted. So, you know, that's how I really got into photography. Yeah. I don't think I ever saw it as an entire career path. I was trying to do this thing to, you know, have extra money while I'm studying to be able to take care of myself and do what I wanted to do without having to bother my mom.
Interesting. What did your mom think about all of this?
Yo, I was raised by a strict mother. So the first 2 years, it was a bit hard to do the stuff. So I always have to be back home early. And then only after third year, I kind of like started going rogue. And then not making it back in time. And then I'd be like, nah, I've got a job, I'm doing this. And then she'd understand. But I think there was one conversation we once had, and it was just about getting into the industry, because she was like, look, you only have 3 years to pass your degree, and that's all I can afford. And I was like, all right, cool. Bet 3 years, let's go. And then I remember I wanted to drop out in second year because it was hard. And then she was like, well, you said 3 years. Gotta finish it. Gotta finish what you started. And then I was like, okay, cool. Then I did. And that kind of showed, you know, like how persevering and finishing what you started could actually change your entire trajectory in life.
Yeah, sure. That's so interesting. I'm also curious to know, how did then your brand grow?
Ooh.
Like, what was there a specific moment that, or was it intentional? Did you have a strategy? How did you start blowing up?
I think everybody remembers me for one specific thing and one specific thing only. And I think it was a combination of 2 years of hard work behind the scenes that people did not really see. So I started photography in 2009 when I was in second year. No, I was in first year in 2009. And I did photography as a second shooter for a guy who was in third year as a wedding shooter. So I'd be like his second shooter. He would do the main pictures. I would do the second half of the images. So let's say if he's shooting the couple, then I'll be shooting the reception where people are chilling, having snacks. Okay. So that's where it started, right? And then right after that, I started shooting friends for vlogs. And then I started doing the events as well. And then from the events, I started shooting, you know, blogging was becoming a popular thing.
Mm.
And then I started shooting blogging with different bloggers and different influencers when the years of influencers started coming in.
Yeah.
And then right after that, I started doing award shows. And I remember the specific time that everybody knew who Austin Malema was in 2017 after I did the Summer Awards in Sun City. And then we posted the images from the red carpet live on the day. And then that's when people were like, okay, now who is this Austin Malema? But even before that, I had been doing stuff with Dineo Mweketi. I'd been doing stuff with Thando Thabete. And some people knew me from that stuff. But I feel like when I really like made it was because of the Summer Awards. And then the same year, I went and did the SAFTAs and then the Metro FM Music Awards. So I think the award shows literally changed the trajectory of my life because no one was doing live content from the red carpet.
So it wasn't a thing.
Yeah. And then to be able to shoot it right now, in the next 10 minutes, it's out on social media and people can see who's wearing what.
Yeah.
That kind of gave me the edge on everybody else because you could show people what the red carpet looked like before the show started.
Yeah.
So, and normally at that time, you'd have to wait until Sunday to see the images because the newspapers were the only people who had the access to that.
Sure.
So we kind of changed the trajectory of red carpet in the country.
Was that intentional to do that?
It was. Mm-hmm. I remember on that specific weekend when we were going to Sun City, we went there with the purpose of posting live, but we didn't know how far it was going to go. It was just like, listen, nobody's doing this right now. Mm-hmm. Let's drive to Sun City, get access, no matter how it works, just get on the carpet, take pictures, edit them on our phones quickly, and then post them.
Wow.
Yeah. Everything was happening. Like literally we would sit there, shoot it on the camera, then pull out our phones, connect the phone to the camera on Bluetooth, download the pictures that you wanted, go into Visco, add a filter, and then put it out.
On Visco even?
Yeah.
Wow.
So those things kind of like, but I think it was also the fact that we were so young and determined to do something and be someone that it changed how we approach things because we were not cautious at all.
Yeah.
We were not cautious. Sure. We were not afraid of failing. We were like, we're going to do it. If it fails, it fails. Yeah. We tried.
Yeah.
But again, and it kind of like caught fire and everybody was like, oh my God, oh my God. And the fact that nobody was doing red carpets like that in the country, I'm just saying in general, just the view of shooting a red carpet from behind the people and not just shooting the popular people, kind of giving you a glance of what it looks like, you know, from the other camera person's point of view. Mm-hmm. It kind of changed how people saw red carpets. Mm. It was not just, okay, cool, here's the outfit alone.
Yeah.
You got little moments of people doing things, being interviewed. That kind of also changed how you viewed a red carpet. Yeah. And then it kind of allowed us to be able to build onto that.
Mm. Do you now see why you are the Austin Malema?
I don't think in building your career you think about those things.
That's
because
true.
Those are little moments of, you know, they're little moments of building that you are doing for yourself without seeing the full picture.
Mm.
And only now when you look back, you're like, okay, cool. That's what you were able to do. This is how you were able to change the trajectory of how this is approached.
Yeah. And I think for visionaries that are entrepreneurs, it's just never enough.
No, it'll never be enough.
It's like you constantly get the itch to do something new that no one else is doing and you'll constantly be chasing that. What are you learning the most about yourself in your entrepreneurial journey?
I'm too kind.
Where do you think that comes from? Why do you think you're too kind?
I think it comes from, this is interesting. I think, and I want to say this, you know, with the utmost respect for the people who raised me, but I think as young people, many of us are coddled from the real world and we're protected from the realities of what the world is until you become an adult and then you have to face, you know, rejection and how bad the world can be too late in your life. And that's the big issue. I feel like most of us are very coddled because our parents think that coddling us is protecting us, but it's just, you know, sheltering us until we get out into the big bad world when you're no longer there.
Tell me, when you say coddling, I'm trying to figure out what does that look like? Is it like asking you to come home at 7 p.m.?
I think that's part of it, but also we never really get to experience what life is really like. No matter how bad you struggle, your parents always make sure that they've got you covered in every aspect. If it's bad at home, you never get to really see it.
I hear what you're saying.
And I understand it, but I think when it gets to a certain age, you need to start experiencing what life could be like.
Mm.
Because if it happens like that, it becomes bad depending on who you are.
Yeah.
I feel like, you know, I'm too soft and I make decisions to try, you know, make people not mad, not sad. But then in the reality of business, it should not matter, right? You should be able to live with making a decision and disappointing someone, and then saying, you know what, I'm sorry I disappointed you, but this is where we are.
Yeah.
You know, and be okay with it. But I feel like many a times we care too much because we were raised in that way, that we're coddled, mm-hmm. that we try to coddle others. Mm. And that's a very bad way to grow up and run a business.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You've been in business for, I think, over 15 years now with what you do.
Yeah.
And you're only learning this about yourself now?
No, I'm only learning to practice to be a person who mm-hmm. is not really affected as much as I was about my decisions. I used to really care how my decisions would make someone act and how affected they would be by what I decide. Right. Mm. But that's also because I've always worked in small teams and I had very personal connections with the people who worked with me. And it makes it hard for you to be able to make decisions that are based on just business and not personal, because the lives are always intertwined. Mm. It doesn't matter how you try to say it's not personal, it's business. Like, business is the most personal thing ever.
Absolutely.
Like, people always say it's not personal, it's just business. But business is very personal for everyone. It's personal because I am working here to try make a living for myself at home. It's personal because I am trying to grow a business and, you know, be the most successful person in what I'm doing. Mm. It's personal for all of us involved. So it's never just business.
Sure. That's very interesting. It really sparked a light bulb. I'm just like, okay. Very, very interesting. And I think the reason why I took a moment is because what you're saying, is it's so powerful coming from you, because this is something we talk a lot often around female entrepreneurs, that we think we are too nice. And it's really based on our background where we watch people's faces and then we instruct people and our teams in a way that we're trying to not make them feel bad or be sad, or you watch your tone. So you must say please and you must put emojis when you text. And just hearing a male go through the same thing is giving me an aha moment. And
but can I tell you why I think part of that is? Mm-hmm. I think for many of us, and I personally for myself as well, we're first-time generation entrepreneurs.
Yeah.
And most of the time, these are first-timers and first-time experiences that we're going through. Mm. And if you've been in a place where, you know, your family has been in business before, I'm very sure life would be different, because you'd be like, yeah, I saw my parents go through this. Or, you know, whoever's mentoring you at that time would be like, yeah, but, you know, you should be able to just deal with it in this way, you know? Mm. And it takes a lot of experience or having mentors around you who are like, yeah, you should be able to deal with it in this way and it shouldn't affect you, you know. And for me, it's also taken, you know, me speaking to my mentors to be like, hey, this is what I'm going through, you know. And then, you know, my one mentor is always like laying it flat the way it is, and he says, this is what it is. Like, it doesn't matter what you do, it doesn't matter what you don't do, mm-hmm. but you still have to make the decision.
Yeah,
that's all it is.
And making no decision is making a decision.
That's it. Ah! And that's the worst decision.
Yeah. That kills me so much, because it's so real. And I think, you know, to your point, and a lot of people that watch the podcast know, so I come from a very entrepreneurial family.
Yes.
My father had been in business, I think, ever since I knew him, together with my mom. Yes. But I want to piggyback off the point you made in the beginning around us being very cuddled, because I was very active in the business, but I was never active when it came to the people and the management. So I was put in to say, go into the store. This is how much money you must make today. Make that money. But if there was an issue, I'd then run to my dad and then he'll sort it out for me. So I think I never got to really see what that sorting out looked like.
Yeah, you never got to deal with the real problems. You only got to deal with the small superficial problems that are very small. You can do that. You can.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people don't understand this, right? And it's also a big thing that I realized in the last 2 years when I started growing my team, that as soon as you grow your team, or you try to grow your team, you are stepping into a territory that you've never been in, especially when it comes to humans, because people act different. You are having 10 different characters who are showing up differently with different problems and different approaches to how they do things.
Yeah.
And you're expecting them to also understand how you approach things. Mm. And that will never work for everyone. And that's the worst part. I feel like, and I'm not saying it in a bad way, it's just like if you've never had to manage a group of people and you get into a point where you now have to manage a large group of people and you want to do it delicately for everybody, you will never please everyone.
Yeah.
And it becomes very hard on you as a person because I care about everyone in my team. I want everyone to be happy. I don't want people to say I'm a bad boss. I don't want anybody to say this. But I've never found anybody who says, you know, well, there are people who've said their bosses are good, but 90% of the bosses I've heard about are not great.
Yeah.
And it doesn't mean that the bosses are great. It just means that the people are not getting what they wanted. Oh, it's not that the boss is bad. It's just that you are not getting what you want the way you want it. So you're going to turn and say your boss is a bad boss.
I've never looked at it like that.
But that's, you know, when
and
you look
at it.
That
is so interesting. It is. You're right.
It's not everybody's going to be a bad boss, guys. Not there's no way that people who are running these companies are all bad and they can grow so well and employ so many people, but the bosses are bad. At what point do we look back and say, you know what? At some point, my boss has done their part. They've done their part. What is my part to play here? And how do I play that part?
That is very setting free. Because when you think, and I think, you know, going back to your point is when we try to please people, the assumption is that whatever they think of me is who I am. So if they say I'm a bad boss, it's like, oh, I'm a bad person. But it's like, no. It's merely because they did not get what they wanted from you. It's there got you nothing go. To do. Oh, my gosh.
That's what it is.
Oh, my goodness.
You got to look at it in that way. Because I don't think a boss ever wakes up and says, I'm going to go make so-and-so's day horrible.
Absolutely.
I think they go there to make sure that they take care of their business. And how they take care of their business is in a way that they see fit for the business.
Yeah.
And the way that will, you know, prosper the business and prosper the teams that work for them.
Yeah.
And if you're not happy with it, then that's when you go around and you say, you know what, I don't like my boss, they do this, then it's okay. Like, you should also be okay with not being liked as an employer. I think that's one of the realest things that can ever happen in life. I think, you know, not being liked is not a bad thing. Not being liked is okay. Because again, you can't please everyone. If you become a people pleaser as an employer, what do you get in the end? How do you reprimand people?
Yeah.
How do you get to a point where the people that work with you understand that, you know what, my employer is saying this because, you know, this is how they want things done. Not the way I want it done, but the way they want it done or the way that best represents what we stand for as a business.
Yeah.
You can't always be like, yeah, I can't say no to this person or I can't tell them they did something badly. There's always, you know, this thing of how you say things is important, not just delivering the message and hoping that everybody gets it. It's how you deliver the message that's important, not what the message is.
Sure. You mentioned earlier that part of how you picked up, you struggled with that, is that you were hiring a lot of people that you were very close to. And I'm also curious to hear your thoughts around hiring friends, family, or people we are close to. Is that something you still do? And what did you learn from that?
So it's a two-part for me.
Okay.
One of the guys who works in my team is my best friend, and he's been with me since day zero of the business. Came from a very different background, and now he is a production manager in my team.
Wow.
And he's been with me for about 7 years now, and that has been amazing. And it just, you know, illustrates that people from a different background can come into a field as long as you guide them and you show them what they need to be doing, and they can be really good at it. It doesn't mean that they have to be qualified for specific things. They're people who are open and willing to learn, and there's nothing wrong with it.
Yeah.
My partner also works in my business, and the best thing about it is she comes from a law background, and I needed someone who could run the business, and I needed someone who can be able to deal with the human factor, because I was struggling with that. that. And she became the best option because she has dealt with, you know, bigger things than I had and bigger challenges that I had in my business. And she was, you know, she knew about all the struggles that I had. You know, I would explain, these are the struggles that I'm having in the business. And this is, you know, and she'd be like, no, why don't you do this? Why don't you do this? And every time I implemented what she said, it worked. And I was like, oh, damn. Okay, cool.
She's right.
Maybe you should be doing this instead of me doing it. And it worked out really well. Yeah. But I just don't believe it will always work out for you or it will always work. I try avoid it. But if you are someone who has, you know, what's the word now? If you're someone who shows that you are able to do it and it's something that you can do, and I believe that you have the capabilities, that's what I was looking for.
Yes.
You have the capabilities to do that, then I don't think there's an issue with hiring, you know, someone from family, someone who's a friend. But it only becomes a difficult thing when they start slacking, and now you need to reprimand them as an employer and not as a friend. Because no matter what happens, it will always be, the bad things will always be taken as a friend. The good things will always be taken as an employer. And that's the difficult part.
Wow.
That's what it is. Because when I compliment you, I'm complimenting you as the boss.
Yes.
But when I reprimand you, but like, you're my friend, don't say that. Don't say it like that. And it's like, it becomes very difficult when you employ friends. I've had to deal with that a few times. And look, it's, you need to either be very stern in what you're saying. And sometimes you need to tell people that there's times where we're going to be friends and the times where I'm going to be your employer. And it's not about the happy or sad times, but when we're in the office, I'm your employer. Yes, we can cackle about being friends at some point, but when I speak about work, I'm speaking about work. Please take off your friendship hat and look at me as an employer. And it's very hard to say that. It's very hard to separate the two. It will always be hard, but it depends on the person who's the employer that is employing and also the friend. I've worked with some of my friends, like, as clients. And I can never take anything they say as, you know, you're criticizing me as a friend. If my company does something and it's bad and they say, yo, I'm not really happy about that, I've come to learn that I need to be like, okay, cool. That's coming from my employer, someone who is paying me to do something, not my friend. My friend will come back to me and say, listen, that was really bad. Can we fix it like this? And sometimes you have clients who will do that because they care about you and they care about your business and what you're doing. And they will come to you and hold your hand and say, can we fix it like this? And sometimes you'll find someone who says, that was really bad. Next time, can you fix it? Again, that's a client. They can be a friend. If they decide to guide you in it and how you fix it, they really care and they invested in what you do. But if they just tell you it's bad, don't ever look at it and be like, oh my God, my friend is such an ass because they just called me out for making a mistake.
It's like, I'll never invite them to my house again.
No.
Because they're not nice people. I want to take this a step further because you mentioned that you work with your partner, and I work with my husband on quite a lot of projects. And there are times where I want to pull my hair out and run away. Because it can be very hard to still get the, I think, the gentleness and the romantic love in a very crucial point in business that could potentially cost us money and we're not agreeing on something. What has that been like for you?
I think it's been very difficult. And it's not the easiest thing to do because I think at some point, you know, especially when it comes to people you're very close to, you do get conflicted on decisions and the way that you communicate, especially when it comes to your partners. Like, trust me, like, that is probably the hardest because you still have to face each other no matter what happens.
After work.
And but the one thing I appreciate about her is she's not afraid to tell me if I am wrong on something. She's not afraid to challenge me. And sometimes I feel like that's also like the worst part because you're like, I'm hoping that you are here with me and you stand with me on this. And then she's the person saying, no, you are wrong. And half the time, you know, you have to sit back and be like, okay, cool. Now am I speaking as a partner or am I speaking as an employer? Mm. And is she speaking to me as a partner or someone who works with me?
Yeah.
And I think, you know, finding the balance is very hard. Yeah. But I also think it's because this is about, it's been about a year. And, you know, until you've done it for a bit longer, you know, and you settle in how you speak to each other about business and how you speak to each other about home, it will always be a challenge. And then when you find the balance, it will work itself out.
Yeah, 100%. You know, to try and mitigate this, my husband started having this thing where he'd say to me, okay, do you want me to, in this case, am I your husband or am I your business partner?
Yeah.
And I'd be like, yo, you're my business partner. And then after he spoke, I'm like, shucks, I hate what you just said. It's
like, I do not like you as a business partner right now.
Okay, maybe come back here. But it's just like, oh, it's so hard because there's obviously so much emotion attached to it. And you're like, ah, oh. But I think, like you said, as time goes, you actually learn that, you know what, this person is saying this because they have their best interest in heart. That's and it. Especially if it's in an industry that you know better. Yes.
And that's the same with us, right? It's in an industry that I come from and I understand better. Yeah. But she's dealt with people a lot more than I have.
Exactly.
So that's a very different thing. Like, so now when you want to tell me about my industry, I also want to outrank you. And it's like, ah. Oh. But then sometimes you have to go back and be like, you know what, perspective from someone outside is always better compared to your perspective.
That's true.
Because then they're looking at it from a client's point of view as well. And you are just looking at it from a professional point of view only.
Yeah. So, yeah. And 99.9% of the time, they are right.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, they are right. You just have to, like, later you're like, oh,
yeah, sometimes you must not admit it though.
Yeah.
Just it's go like, on with it.
Whatever.
Cool.
And then halfway through, you're like, yeah, they're really right. It's so interesting when you work with different people, because I think as your team grows, so for me, right, my thing is always like, we are building businesses to, yes, feed ourselves and fulfill a specific vision, but also give people opportunities that are around us.
True.
You know, I want to give my family members, I want to give my close friends who need the opportunity with whatever it is that I'm doing. But it's obviously very complex when you bring family and friends around, because now it's like the hats are being mixed and it's just... Ah, it can be a little bit difficult.
It will always be difficult. I try not to do work for family. I try not to work too close with family, because I believe, just like we spoke about working with our partners, I believe that at some point people forget that if you hire me as a photographer and you are a family member, I'm coming there as a professional. I'm not coming there as a family member.
Yeah.
And then you're going to disregard what I'm saying because I am your family member.
Yeah.
And you think, no, just do this. And I'm like, no, do this. But if I hired a different professional to come do exactly that, you're going to follow it because you believe that that is the good thing or the right thing to do.
Yeah.
So I always try. And I've made it a thing with my family. If you say, hey, I'm looking for a photographer for this, I'm like, okay, cool. Happy to pay someone. Happy to get someone. You know, because I understand that I don't want to be disregarded by family members. I don't want family members to not take me seriously because we are family. I know you so well.
Yes.
Like, why are you telling me to do this? I'm telling you to do that because it looks good on the picture.
Yes.
And now you're not going to do it.
Yeah.
I'm going to get mad as a professional.
Of course.
Because you did not give me what I needed.
Yeah.
So it always becomes that complicated thing, and I'm like, you know what, the best way to do it is stay far away from family when it's, you know, work. I will employ other people, I will pay other people to come do the work because you will listen to them with no issue.
Yeah.
And I can also sit and enjoy what we are doing as a family.
That's
so
true.
It becomes one of those things. And it also took me a while to realize that I used to go to family events and photograph, but I was like, never goes well.
Yeah.
So I'm going to stay away from it.
And then they want the pictures tonight.
Tonight. Thanks. No, no.
Can you guys, Austin, no, where is Zipi Tombe?
No.
Where are the pictures,
no,
Austin?
Trust you, me. All of these things, I think, take a lot of experience and a lot of time and a lot of failures to learn what you want to do and what you're willing to do and how far you're willing to go.
Yeah.
You know, beyond just the partners, beyond just the family, you know, it's all in learning and also the type of person that you want to be, because there are people who probably have gone through the challenges and they're okay to go through it. And there are people who are like, you know what, the challenge of working with family is hard. I don't want to do it at all. Like, like, I'd rather just show up and look at, you know, look and be part of the family and look out instead of, you know, sitting there and trying to do work and then getting mad at my aunt for not doing something. So I'm just like, nah, let's not do that.
Makes sense. Yeah. I'm a firm believer that for any business to grow, the entrepreneur needs to be growing themselves. And I'd like to know, what is your growth? Is there a routine, regime, whatever it is? Is there specific things that you are doing or that you do to stay ahead of the game for your business?
So there's a few things that I tell you that I do. Like I always say I'm a people watcher, right?
Okay.
So especially when I'm working, I watch people and what they're doing so that I can get the best moment. But I also watch people outside of work, especially in my industry, and I watch what they're doing so that I can look at the opportunities that are left behind or what they're not doing and then use those as my loopholes. Because by watching what people are doing, you'll see where the industry is gravitating towards. And then you can also see where the opportunities are for you. So you can insert yourself into those opportunities that they're not in.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people like to create or follow trends, right? A trend will start and then people will go onto that. Yeah. And sometimes I'm part of the people following the trend. I will follow the trend, but I'm also watching the other guys. Like, okay, cool. What are you doing? What is it that you're doing differently compared to the other 10 guys who are in the same space doing exactly what you're doing? And then we'll say, okay, cool. Nobody's doing this. Then we're going to go ahead and do this. For example, during COVID, and I always say this is one of the best examples, is everybody wanted to do live streaming. You know, that was great.
Yes.
But nobody was going on set for TV shows, films, and doing behind the scenes and telling people about the shows that are coming. That's where we made our money during COVID.
Interesting.
There you go. People are always interested in the simpler things that everybody is putting in front of them.
Yeah.
And sometimes just sitting back and saying, okay, cool. What else is next? If nobody is showing, you know, the upcoming films or the you know, the pictures for the streamers or the shows, what else can we do? You know, and I think that's the one thing. But again, you know, I'm always, you know, I'm never happy with anything I do. So I'm always motivated by, you know, my next project. I always say that my best project is my next project.
Yeah.
I have no favorite kids, not, like in reality with my kids, but also with my project. Because the big thing about it is each project stands for a little, represents a specific time in my career. And I need to move on from that because once you can hold on to a project and you say, my favorite project is this, then that means that was your peak or your pinnacle. Sure. But you, if you never hold on to anything, you always want to do better. Like anybody who has a favorite project, I believe personally, and anybody can say, you know, what they want to say, but I believe that having a favorite project means that you have a favorite child and you think that you can't do anything better than that.
Interesting. Very interesting. How many children do you have?
I've got two kids. Two beautiful kids, a son and a girl.
Okay. And you don't have a favorite?
No.
You don't have a soft spot for the other?
No, I can't.
The girl doesn't get her way more than the guy.
Oh, but she does because she's the youngest. But I don't think it's because of a favorite. Okay. She's just the youngest. If they were the same age, I'd be like, hey, peace out.
Yeah. Like go fend for yourself and do what your brother is doing.
But I think just because she's younger, I still have to, you know, be there and guide her through, you know, little things that are happening.
Yeah.
But once she becomes, my son is 9 years old. Once she hits like the 9 year olds, I don't think we're going to be, you know, holding a hand like that.
Yeah.
She's gonna be like, peace out, dad. I'm gonna go do my own thing.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna be like, okay, cool. Goodbye.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Tell me a little bit more about pricing. You mentioned earlier that you started charging 500 rand per night.
I don't want to look back there.
I mean, for those that are listening, especially when we refer you to as the Austin Malima, they know that it doesn't come cheap, right? Take us through that. And I know, obviously, when you started working with celebrities, was it pro bono? Was it like just to get your name out there? Or did you actually charge them a price that makes you smile?
Pricing is very tricky. Let's just start there.
Extremely,
because you don't want to lose out on money.
Yeah.
When I was working by myself, I had a rate card that kind of represented what I do. There's a little trick that I have, but I'll tell you about it.
Please, tell us. Tell us what you want to learn.
A little trick.
Yeah?
But the big thing about it is you need to know what you're willing to stop at, where you're willing to not move from.
Okay.
And that becomes your base. No matter what happens, if you're going to charge R5 and you know that you will take it for R3, then charge R5.
Mm.
And then when they negotiate, you stop at R3 because you already know that you are happy at R3.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the one way that I kind of get away with many things,
okay,
in terms of my costs, right? So mm-hmm. what I will do is a project comes in and they say, hey, Austin, how are you doing? So we're doing this shoot and can you cost us, you know, this amount? I'm like, okay, cool, no problem. My real amount is going to be R10,000.
Mm-hmm.
But I know that if I have to negotiate below R7,000, I'm not doing it.
I see.
That's it.
Okay.
It's the only way you're going to be able to, you know, trick the system, I think, yeah, right? Because I know that my real rate is R7,000.
Mm.
But I am going to be happy at R10,000.
Of course.
R10,000 makes me happy.
Yes.
This is, if you are not trying to cut anything off, shave anything off, R10,000 is my real rate.
Yeah.
But if anything has to be moved mm-hmm. and shifted, my number is going to be 7.
That is such an amazing pricing strategy. There's this thing that I like saying, to say you must charge a price that makes you smile.
Yes. What makes me smile yeah. is the 10.
Nice.
What makes me happy is the 7.
Shucks. Interesting. And I think what a lot of people mistake... or the mistake that they make, rather, is that they charge 7.
Yes, they charge 7, and then they start negotiating from 7, yes, going to 5.
Going to 5. And yes, it's like, now you hate everything.
There you go. And that's the issue. Like, you need to be aware of how to, you know, price yourself in a way that no matter how much you negotiate, you yeah. are not at a loss.
Hmm.
That's it.
Sure. Very interesting. Now, obviously, we're in a day and age where everything is so digital. And I think photography is like taking a peek, because we're now buying phones depending on the camera quality and how we are able to edit them themselves, all of that other stuff.
Yes, ma'am.
And from you, as the sought after photographer, we would like some tips to be photogenic. So what would you say for somebody, maybe let's say I want to build a brand, or I just want to be better on photos. What do I need to do? You took some pictures of me at Agenda Woman 2 years ago.
2 years ago.
Two years ago. I still have them as my
profile.
It's a year ago.
Yeah.
Shucks.
Second one was this year.
Yes, I remember. I still have them as my profile pictures,
yes,
because they are that good. And I remember I kept saying, please direct me. I don't know what to, I will smile like a 5-year-old and I end there and I don't know what to do.
Yeah.
But the direction made the pictures look out of this world.
Yeah. So I always think the first thing, you know, when people say, walk into camera and they say, mm-hmm. I'm not photogenic, what you've done is already blocked the moment, because you already believe that you're not photogenic.
Mm.
So you're just stepping into the camera just to take the photo. And that always becomes, you know, a point of contention with people who step in front of my camera and they're like, oh my God, I'm not photogenic. I'm like, change your mindset first.
Okay.
Walk in front of the camera,
mm-hmm.
and then I can tell you what to do. But by you saying you're not photogenic, you're just there to literally tick a box, take the photo and I'm out.
Mm.
And that becomes the first step.
Yeah.
And then when it comes to taking photos, I think connecting with your subject is always important.
Mm-hmm.
I speak a lot. I speak to people
on set.
I will speak to you so that you become relaxed, mm-hmm. and then it becomes an interaction between you and I.
Okay.
It's not just a task,
mm.
because the more relaxed people are, the easier it is to get what you want out of them.
Mm.
I've always seen doesn't matter who you're working with.
Yeah.
You could be working with the most talented actor, musician, whoever they are, and they could be in front of the camera like for years. But the first set of images are probably like not the easiest because they're still getting adjusted to taking the photos.
Yeah.
But when you get relaxed and you start speaking and then you now have a connection between you and the subject, it becomes easier to get what you want. And also being very vocal about what you are looking for as a photographer, to say, look, I need you to lift your chin, turn your head to the left, and then do this. It becomes the easiest way because you are directing someone. And then sometimes even clowning yourself, I will show people what I want them to do. Right? And then they're like, oh, okay, cool. And then they're like, just like this. And I'm like, yes, now just lift your hand up just a little and then do this. And then they find themselves in the position from a joke. And then they're like, oh my God, okay, cool, that's beautiful. And then it's like, yes, all it needs is a moment of connection between you and the subject and make them feel comfortable in front of your camera. As soon as, you know, I really don't like it when people come in and they're like, yeah, dude, I really don't want to do this. I don't, because now you're dampening my mood. I'm excited and I want to do this. And you're like, yeah, look, I don't look great. I'm like, okay, cool. What can we do? Before we even do anything. Ooh, sorry.
No, it's fine. Don't worry.
Yeah. So it's always like, how can I get someone comfortable as quick as possible so that we can make it as quick and painless for them and for myself? And then at some point, you end up becoming like great friends with the people that you're photographing. And they're like, you know what? I've never been photographed like that. And it's like, yes, it's because I made you feel comfortable. I didn't just say, do this, do this.
Yeah.
I connected with you. And it's a thing that I also learned from one of my favorite photographers. His name is Platon. What he does is he'll research his subjects before they come in. And then he will have a topic of conversation to chat to them about.
Oh, wow.
And then it gets them calm before the shoot so that when you sit in front of him, you're already calm. You've connected with him on a personal level. So it becomes easier for him to photograph you.
That is so good. And I think it translates into just being a business principle. Like, just know who your customer is.
That's it.
And get granular about them, which is so important. I remember when we did our shoot, you had music playing. Was that intentional?
I think it was intentional to get everybody relaxed. And also remember, it was an all ladies event and we were playing music for the ladies.
Yes.
So it was intentional. Okay. But again, it also, like, you know, people sing, people get into a groove very differently.
Yes.
You play some of their favorite songs and then you find them relaxing quicker.
Yeah.
Because this is where you are. So kind of like finding little moments to help people ease themselves into the activity becomes a way of you getting into their heads slowly. And then you're like, oh, okay, cool. I didn't notice that. And then you're like, yeah, but you came in, you were singing, and then we danced around or we sang, you know, part of the lyrics, and then you're relaxed. The quicker you can connect with your subject, the easier it becomes.
Yes.
And we didn't have a lot of time to take those photos, by the way.
Yeah, it was very quick.
It was very quick because we had to photograph all the speakers.
Yeah.
But as soon as, you know, when you left, I think there was probably, there was someone who was coming next. And, you know, what I would do is chat to them first before I take the photo.
Nice.
And then I take the photo because it's easy to connect.
Yeah.
And then once you've connected, it's easy to just say, do this, do this. And then you get the photos that you're looking for. And then we move on. Everybody's happy.
That is so awesome. I mean, the picture I have as my profile picture, it's my husband's like screensaver.
Oh,
like,
my
it's,
God. That's
it's such
amazing.
It's such a stunning picture. I was going through Instagram and I bumped into these images and they just took me through like a train of thought.
Yes.
And they were from the Shaka Ilembe cast.
Cast, yes.
And when those pictures are taken, they are in character.
Yeah.
On the pictures.
Yes.
What was that like? Like, what?
I think that was amazing. Yeah. I think, you know, sometimes you get opportunities to work on groundbreaking projects.
Yeah.
And no matter how you contribute to it, you always feel like you are part of it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And for us to do that, I remember it was, we just literally said, guys, we know that there's the launch that's coming.
Mm-hmm.
Can we, you know, on the day that we're doing the media run, do these photos, right? And then they were like, yeah, there's no spaces. We're like, look, we'll find a little corner somewhere.
Yeah.
We won't bother nobody. Literally throw us in there and then give us like 2 minutes with each of them.
Yeah.
Literally. And to sit there and just, you know, and what made it even easier for us to take those photos is because we had interviews with them before. right?
Okay.
And then we knew the characters.
Okay.
So it was easier to say, when you spoke about the character, this is what you mentioned. When you were shooting this day, this is what you mentioned. Mm-hmm. And then we would try drive them towards that moment again for each of those photos, and then just direct them on the character that they described, the sort of person that this character is, and what we want to see out of that. And it became very easy. Like, it's this, it's that thing of knowing, you know, what you're looking out for in each character, and knowing that, okay, this is the type of person and this is how they react to situations. So can you do this for me? And then the guys would be, and it's always easy directing actors because they play with emotions quite a bit.
Yes.
So that's always the easiest thing to do, because when you say this and then you're like, okay, dial it up a bit. Okay, too far, dial it down. And then it's like, okay, cool, perfect. That's the shot. And then done.
I actually thought it was the opposite, because I thought it probably is much easier to get in character during a conversation and, you know, during the screenplay. But it's like on a photo, this person has to get in character and be still in character. That for me seemed very difficult.
No, I think it's the easiest one. It's for one moment. And you just dial in that little moment, and then you just push up, like, how much anger do you want? How much happiness do you want? In between sadness, this is what I want you to do with your eye. This is what I want. And it's like, oh, okay, cool. Little building blocks for each little moment.
Yeah. Whew, that is amazing. That's really, really amazing. The last thing I want to ask you is, I think photography is a very special skill. There's like a certain way you look at things, all right?
Yes.
Where you edit things a certain way. You're able to kind of envision it before it actually starts happening.
Yes.
And I'm curious to know, like, what is it for you? So when you are taking pictures or you're on set, what are you looking for?
Ooh, I think it's difficult, to be honest with you, to know exactly what I'm looking for, because I can have all the references for what I'm looking for in the beginning, right? But once you get on set, things could change for the worst or the best. You can't predict it. You can't predict it. And I want to make this example. Yeah. Like, you know, yesterday I was on set and we had a board and we had lit the set, and the talent walked in. I shot a couple of shots from, you know, straight on, right? And I remember it's for a magazine cover. And I remember the editor walking in and saying, love that shot, love that shot. And I was like, okay, cool, amazing. He's happy, but I'm not, right? And there was something in my mind that was saying, try something else, right? And I remember seeing stairs on the side of the studio. And I was like, no, let me go up the stairs and then shoot him looking up at us. And then we made him very small. And in all of it, it's always trying to find the perspective that nobody is seeing for me, because everybody's seeing it from one perspective. And I remember, I wish I could tell you who this cover star is, but
is it currently confidential
but when it comes out, you'll see it in the thing. And the cover is him and his shadow in a white backdrop, and you can see his shadow fully on, and he's very small in the picture. But it's very impactful when you see it.
Nice.
And it's like, the big thing about it is always finding a different perspective that changes how you view the subject you're photographing.
Yeah.
Because some people just want, you know, it depends on who you are. And that's why I'm saying I'm always obsessed with doing my next best thing.
Yeah.
Because it doesn't stop on this project. Mm-hmm. It's like, okay, cool. I've got the shot here. The people who are paying for me to be here are happy.
Yeah.
Cool. But I want something else for myself that would make me happy.
Yes.
And we're able to go and shoot that. And, you know, in the end, they're like, oh, we love that more. And it's like, thank you. I get it.
Yes.
Like, it takes a little understanding to, and a little deviation from the brief. And sometimes playing around and getting, you know, things that people don't think about. I can't really explain it, but in my mind, getting the normal shot is great when you are there. Get the shot, and I always say, I'll get the shot that you want, but can I do one for myself? I'll do what you want, and I'll do one for myself.
Yeah.
And the pictures that I do for myself is just to be able to express myself as well in the best way possible. So I believe when I walk on set, I'm looking to get the client's goal achieved, number mm-hmm. one, but I'm also looking to create some sort of art for myself on top of that. I'm not there just to satisfy the brief alone,
yeah.
but it's there to satisfy the brief and also satisfy my creative execution as an artist as mm-hmm. well.
Sure. I'm learning so much from what you're saying, because essentially you're saying the bar is you.
Yeah, you are the bar.
You are the bar.
You determine whether yes. it stops now yeah. or it carries on a bit more. Yeah.
You are the bar, not the client.
Yeah.
Because sometimes you can do something so ordinary and the client could say it's amazing because it's you.
You, yeah. And then you're in a tricky space, because you always have to think about it. Like, would I be happy with that?
Yeah.
Like, on its own? Or would I do something sure. else and have that at the back of my hand? Because, again, we always judge ourselves in accordance to what we see as important to us
yeah.
and what we determine to be art for mm. ourselves. I don't make art for the next person. I make it for myself.
Yeah.
I photograph great images not because I'm worried about how someone is going to receive it out there. No, I do it because of how I am seeing the world I'm in right now mm. and the best way I can represent it.
Mm.
And I don't have to worry about people who are going to, you know, see my work, because when they see my work, I cannot determine how they feel because of where my work meets them in their life.
Yeah.
So that becomes very tricky, where you're like, oh, I'm doing it to make other people happy. No, I do it to make myself happy when I'm taking that image. Yeah. When you see it and if you connect with it, that's amazing. If yeah. you don't connect with it, that's cool. also okay, because I did not do it to connect with everyone.
Mm. Whew, that is so powerful. Austin, my last question for you.
Yes, ma'am.
Is if you were to leave a message for yourself in 5 years, what would you say to him?
I think that's very tricky. I think that's very tricky, because the next 5 years, I don't know why I'm going to be or what I'm going to be doing. But what I would say is, do not fear the outcome. It does not matter. Like, in the end of it, if you fear the outcome, what's the point of doing it? Because if you just put yourself forward and you just do it anyway, the outcome will be the outcome.
Mm-hmm.
Whether it's good or bad, it will be the outcome. You know, someone said, when was this? I think it was yesterday. Again, too many things have been happening lately. I was having a conversation with another assistant on set yesterday. Mm-hmm. And I remember the part of the conversation that I took home was, it doesn't matter what happens, someone still has to do it. It does not matter what the outcome is, someone still has to do the job. And if it's you, just do the job. Do not fear the outcome. Do not fear it. Do not contemplate it. Just do the job.
Whew. Austin Malema, everybody. Thank you so much. Thank you for coming. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me. I really, really appreciate it.
This has been amazing. I enjoyed this episode.
Thank you.
Very much.
I appreciate it. This was a different conversation for me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm glad. Oh, Resonate community, I hope that you guys enjoyed this as much as I did, because there were so many amazing nuggets that Austin shared in here. Thank you so much for watching. Let us know in the comment section, what is the one thing that actually gave you that light bulb moment? We love you guys so much, and we'll see you guys on our next podcast episode. Goodbye.